आप सभी का इंदिरा गांधी राष्ट्रीय कला केंद्र के कल्चरल इन्फॉर्मेटिक्स मल्टीमीडिया शोध केंद्र द्वारा आयोजित इस व्याख्यान कार्यक्रम में आपका स्वागत करता हूँ। आज के हमारे व्याख्यान का शीर्षक है सोपान संगीत, केरल के मंदिरों में प्रचलित संगीत की विशिष्ट गायन शैली। और आज की हमारी वक्ता हैं प्रोफेसर दीप्ति ओमचेरी भल्ला। मैं प्रोफेसर प्रताप आनंद झा जी और प्रोफेसर दीप्ति ओमचेरी भल्ला जी से रिक्वेस्ट करता हूं कि प्लीज़ स्टेज पर विराजमान हो। आई नाउ रिक्वेस्ट प्रोफेसर प्रताप आनंद झा, डायरेक्टर कल्चरल इन्फॉर्मेटिक्स, टू प्लीज़ इंट्रोड्यूस द स्पीकर फॉर टुडे।
इंदिरा गांधी राष्ट्रीय कला केंद्र के इस सभागार में उपस्थित सभी कला प्रेमियों, संगीत साधकों और केंद्र के सभी अधिकारियों एवं कर्मचारियों का मैं स्वागत करता हूँ। केंद्र के राजभाषा विभाग के विमर्श से आयोजित आज के व्याख्यान का विषय है सोपान संगीत, केरल के मंदिरों में प्रचलित संगीत की विशिष्ट गायन शैली। और वक्ता हैं प्रोफेसर दीप्ति ओमचेरी भल्ला। प्रोफेसर दीप्ति ओमचेरी भल्ला संगीत और नृत्य के विख्यात कलाकार हैं। कलाकार के साथ साथ आप में एक विदुषी, लेखक और शिक्षाविद का दुर्लभ संयोजन है। आप दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय के कर्नाटक संगीत की प्रोफेसर हैं और वर्तमान में डीन और विभागाध्यक्ष हैं, जहां आप पिछले 35 वर्षों से पढ़ा रही हैं। आपने अपनी माँ पद्मश्री डॉक्टर लीला ओमचेरी, जो एक प्रख्यात संगीतविद हैं, से सोपान संगीत में प्रशिक्षण लिया है। केरल के प्रसिद्ध गुरुओं से कथकली में 12 साल के कठोर प्रशिक्षण के बाद आपने दिवंगत कला मंडलम कल्याणी कुट्टियम्मा से मोहनी अट्टम की शिक्षा ग्रहण की। आपने डॉक्टर लीला ओमचेरी के साथ कई पुस्तकें प्रकाशित की हैं, जिनमें अभिनय संगीतम, केरल थिले लास्य रचनाकाल, करुणा कैवन आदि कई दुर्लभ रचनाएं शामिल हैं। आपकी पुस्तक वेनिसिंग टेम्पल आर्ट्स ऑफ केरला की प्रति भारत के पूर्व राष्ट्रपति डॉक्टर APJ अब्दुल कलाम को प्रस्तुत किया गया और फ्रैंकफर्ट पुस्तक प्रदर्शनी में भी उसे प्रदर्शित किया गया था। आप प्रतिष्ठित स्वर भारती जर्नल, जो संगीत और नृत्य की राष्ट्रीय पत्रिका है और जिसे भारतीय विद्या भवन दिल्ली द्वारा प्रकाशित की जाती है, की संपादक रही हैं। आपके लेखों में बृहद्देशी, संगीत रत्नाकर, संगीत पारिजात, संगीत दर्पण, संगीत समयसार, मानसोल्लास और भाव प्रकाशन जैसे संस्कृत ग्रंथ शामिल हैं। आप संगीत विभाग द्वारा प्रकाशित UGC 2019 केयर पीयर रिव्यूड जर्नल रिसर्च जर्नल वागीश्वरी की एडिटर इन चीफ हैं। आपको राष्ट्रीय और अंतर्राष्ट्रीय पत्रिकाओं में कई शोध पत्र प्रकाशनों का श्रेय है। आपके पेपर में लासिया कॉन्सेप्ट एंड एप्लीकेशन इन मोहिनीअट्टम, मूड्स एंड एक्सप्रेशन इन रिथम्स ऑफ केरला, द इन्फ्लुएंस ऑफ गीत गोविंद इन द परफॉर्मिंग आर्ट्स ऑफ केरला, इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ बलराम भरतम इन अंगिका अभिनय ऑफ मोहिनीअट्टम, डिस्टिंक्टिव फीचर्स ऑफ सोपान म्यूजिक आदि प्रमुख हैं। आप इंदिरा गांधी राष्ट्रीय कला केंद्र के साथ लगभग 3 दशक से जुड़ी हैं और केंद्र के मल्टीमीडिया प्रोजेक्ट गीत गोविंद में अपना योगदान दिया है। राष्ट्रीय पांडुलिपि मिशन नई दिल्ली द्वारा आयोजित राष्ट्रीय संस्कृत संस्थान बलाहार हिमाचल प्रदेश में नाट्यशास्त्र के पाठों पर राष्ट्रीय संगोष्ठी में आपने लेक्चर कम डेमोन्स्ट्रेशन प्रस्तुत किया, जिसका विषय था मोहिनी अट्टम के संदर्भ से भरत मुनि की लोकधर्मी और नाट्यधर्मी की विवेचना। IGNCA नई दिल्ली और काकातिया विरासत ट्रस्ट द्वारा आयोजित राष्ट्रीय संगोष्ठी में आपने लेक्चर कम डेमो प्रस्तुत किया। राष्ट्रीय पांडुलिपि मिशन द्वारा आयोजित संगीत की संस्कृति पांडुलिपियाँ महत्वपूर्ण संस्करण और उसका महत्व विषयक तत्वबोध व्याख्यान भी आपकी आपने अध्यक्षता की। आपकी मोहिनी अट्टम की कई संगीत CD और DVD प्रकाशित हो चुकी हैं। BBC हिंदी चैनल ने आर्टिस्ट एट वर्क के अंतर्गत आपका एक प्रोफाइल वेबकास्ट किया था। आप कई पुरस्कारों से सम्मानित हैं, जिनमें केंद्रीय संगीत नाटक एकेडमी पुरस्कार 2008, नारद गणसभा पुरस्कार 2008, केरल संगीत नाटक अकादमी पुरस्कार 2007 आदि प्रमुख हैं। आप मोहिनी अट्टम के दूरदर्शन के शीर्ष श्रेणी के कलाकार हैं। ICCR विदेश मंत्रालय भारत सरकार के उत्कृष्ट कलाकार के पैनल में आप शामिल हैं। संगीत इष्ट तक पहुंचने का सबसे सुगम मार्ग है, गायन की शैली यदि खास तौर से मंदिरों के लिए हो तो वह और विशिष्ट हो जाती है। विश्व शिक्षक दिवस पर इस विषय पर आपसे जानना एक सुखद संयोग है। आज के व्याख्यान के लिए आपने हमारी निवेदन स्वीकार की, इसके लिए हम आपके आभारी हैं और आपका स्वागत करते हैं।
थैंक यू सर। मे आई नाउ रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर सुधीर लाल टू प्लीज फेलिसिटेट प्रोफेसर दीप्ति ओमचेरी भल्ला जी ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ IGNCA। I now request Professor Deepthi Omchari Bhallaji to make her presentation.
Namaskar. It's a great pleasure for me, and also I consider it my privilege to be once again be present here in this IGNCA organization, institution, which has done considerable efforts to promote and inculcate culture all over India. And I'm very privileged to be a part of this kind of a movement that this institution has started way back, almost 2.5 decades back. I did this multimedia project with IGNCA, which was a Geeta Govinda project, and I had the opportunity of presenting along with my mother the Sopana Sangeetam. And I had also fortunately learned Sopana Sangeetam from my mother, who learned through the oral tradition from her grandmother, Gauri Kutti Pilla, and her mother, Lakshmi Kutti Amma, and also from Sri Subramaniam, who was then the Ashan at the Thiruvattar Adikeshava temple in Kanyakumari district, from where a small little village from where my mother hails from. She also had the privilege of learning through oral tradition great masters of Sopana Sangeetam at the Parashala Suchindram temple also. So I consider it a blessing that I could understand this music, which at that time, perhaps it was not known to many people, the intricacies and the beauty that was inherent in this style. So this opportunity that IGNCA has given me today to share some of the clippings that my, through the recordings that I could gather from them and give a small little talk, though I don't consider myself an authority because my mother, I'm actually representing my mother, Padmashri Dr. Leela Omchari, who could unfortunately not be present here today because of this pandemic situation. Otherwise, I would have been accompanying her here. But representing my mother, I would like to share this small little talk with all of you. You heard just now the first sound of edekya, which is actually a melodious instrument as compared to many other drumming instruments of Kerala, which are a little too loud and harsh, when they the sound of which when they fall upon your ears, and you can seldom actually enjoy their sound. But edekka is an instrument now, of course, primarily used for the female characters in many of the traditional art forms of Kerala, including the Kathakali and Mohiniyattam. But this edekya has a very resounding and sonorous sound. The moment you enter the Kerala temple, the sound of this edekya, when the sanctum door is closed, and for the Kuttipadi Sevaka, the person who sings devotional songs standing near the steps of the temple sanctum, drumming this instrument and singing the devotional songs, the bhakta immediately gets connected to the Lord. The devotion within you, the bhava, immediately comes upon. And actually, that is the reason this instrument is called as edekka. It is edekka means an instrument that comes in between the bhakta and the Lord. So that instrument immediately gives you an environment of devotion all around. And the second slide that you saw with Dr. Leela Omcheri rendering the Sopana Ashtapadi Shloka, you would have found that there is a nasal tone. It is quite unlike the melodious tonal quality of a female singer. It has a nasal sound. There are certain nuances which are very, very typical of Sopana Sangeetam, with certain jerks, certain vibrations, certain kampita, kampanam. All these things are very much part of the Sopana Sangeetam, which both my mother and I, we try to analyze when we visited all these temples in Kerala during my PhD in Sopana Sangeetam in 1990s. This music we call Sopana Sangeeta is a distinct singing style of music rendered mainly at the sanctum in the temples of Kerala. With its inclusion in the music of stage performances like Kathakali within the temple precincts, later in the music of Mohiniyattam also, it developed and expanded, finding new dimensions in its expressions, stemmed out of a rich musical heritage, without compromising with its intrinsic quality typically found in the music of the region. The music has all its prerequisites of an Indian classical music, namely the Hindustani and the Carnatic. It has swara, it has raga, it has tala, it has gamaka and compositions. Yet, unlike the classical music which lays emphasis on raga elaborations, the Sopana Sangeetam, so as to enhance the effect of the temple rituals performed at different hour of the day in the devotee, stresses only upon those notes and musical phrases of a raga which best express the desired bhava, while omitting the others, thus not covering the entire raga as ordained in the Raga Lakshana exposition in the Indian classical music. This distinct aspect was often overlooked by the classical music Puritans. This I am talking about way back in 70s and 80s. Who judged its exposition according to the Raga Lakshanas provided in the Shastras. With the growing popularity of Carnatic music in South, the regional music of all southern regions faced a setback. The traditional practitioners of music, even though were masters of their art, were neither musicologists nor pandits of this textual Shastras, and so had the limitation of articulating their voice, which was in a written form. They best kept alive their tradition through performance carried on from generation to generation. I remember very distinctly when I met Janardhanan Nedungadi, the famous Sopana singer in Kerala. When he used to sing, I used to ask him, why this particular phrase in this? Can you help me analyze this phrase? And he would tell me, no, I learned from master, my guru. And when I learned, I just orally imbibed that. I did not think it necessary to analyze each and every swara and phrase as you do in classical music? Well, if it interests you, you can yourself analyze and see what I'm singing, and you can put it down in a notation form. Because according to him, the moment you put down a musical phrase into a notation written form, that essence and the emotive quality which lies in that phrase, that comes out through the singer's own emotions and thoughts, get lost. So this is something we often face when we interact with traditional musicians, because the moment we try to analyze and note it down, the essence is lost. And this is what I experienced from my interaction with many of the sopana singers. Before we go further into this singing style, it's important for us to understand the music of the region. The early music of Kerala till 15th century was given a collective term called pa or pat, which lacked strict notation and possessed a spontaneity, rustic beauty, and emotional appeal. They were devotional, recreational, and historical. In many of these songs, the words have only a secondary consideration in which each syllable can be lengthened to any duration. These were stotras. They had panar paattu, which to ward off the evil, kalamiruthu paattu, kaniyar paattu, ona paattu, unyal paattu, and many other songs which came under this genre. These songs have simple diction and melody, which is sometimes rustic yet sweet and unadorned purity. An interesting feature about many of them is that they are rendered purely for their rhythm and melody, with no thought or care sometimes even for harmony with the accompanying instruments. Unnai Variyar, the 18th century celebrated music composer of Kerala, in a popular Kathakali play Nalacharitam, has transformed many of these folk tunes into compositions enriching their melody and rhythm. This whole song takes a long time, and gradually there is an ascent of speed in this song, which is devotional in praise of the Bhagavati, and gradually it ascends to a kind of a crescendo. And this Kalamiruthu part is a very popular Kalamiruthu, that is when you draw on the floor, is a very popular ritualistic art with drawings of deities, especially Bhagavati, and sarpa on the floor, which are called as kalam. Different colors that represent the panchabhutas, red, green, black, white, are used while drawing the deity, which begins from feet and ends at the eyes. The drawing of the eyes symbolizes the prana element or the life breath in the deity. The kalamiruttha particle or songs glorify different deities whose figures are gradually erased through simple dance steps. They connote Srishti when they are in the form of being drawn. At the time of completion, it's called as Sthiti. And while they erase the entire kalam, it is called as Samhara. So Srishti, Sthiti and Samhara. And the instruments are also very typical that are used in Kalamiruttha, which are Kurum Kuril, that is a small double reed windpipe resembling a Shehnai, also called as Mukhaveena in Tamil Nadu and Mauri in Andhra. Nantuni, a two string plucked instrument, a lute, Veena, Idakka and Udukka, a small hourglass shaped drum resembling the Indian Damaru. And Ilathalam, medium-sized cymbals which are found adopted in its practicing performances. This is the sanctum where the temple drummer, who is called as the Kotti Padi Sevakar, the Kotti means the drumming, Padi means the singing, and Sevakar, of course, the one who does the seva. So the Kotti Padi Sevakar stands near the sanctum of the temple. And when the door is closed and the puja is being performed by the priest, at that time he sings certain devotional songs and thereby creating an environment of worship and devotion. Now here, this is called as a Parishavadim, which is again used as part of the Kerala temple rituals. There is this on the right, the first instrument is called as Thimila. And the next one is a Mukhaveena, which is a small little wind instrument. And adjacent to that, there's an artist standing who is playing the Ilathalam. Of course, it's not very clear in this photograph. Then on the right side, from the other side, you have a big drum, which is called as Vikka Chanda. And this is different from the chanda that you find in the Kathakali. That here, because this is exclusively played for the temple rituals, it is called as the Deva Vadyam. And the moment it is used for any performances, like the stage performances, it changes into what we call as the Asura Vadyam. So the performances for temple rituals, the same chanda becomes a Deva Vadya. And along with him, you have the Kumbha, that is a round semicircular shaped wind instrument.
Adhatam gandumasaktam chiramanuraktam ladagrahe drishtva talcharidam govinde manasijamande sahi. Pashyati deshi deshi rahasi bhavandam Pashyati deshi deshi rahasi bhavandam Udadara madura madu nipibandam Pashyati deshi Siva Bandam Udadhara Madhura Madhuni Pibandam Todapi Sarana Ravasena Valambi Todapi Sarana Ravasena Valambi Hare Sita Deva
Sopana music, or the music which is sung from the sanctum, the steps at the sanctum, of course, it's a very old tradition in the temple, followed in the temples of Kerala. But the Sopana term came into being around the 8th century when temples with Vimana, Gopura, Sri Koval and Sopana were built in Kerala. There was a spurt in the building of temples all over southern India, and Kerala was no exception. While Sopana denotes the stony steps that led to the sanctum sanctorum, Sangeeta is the music rendered by the temple singers who remain near the Sopana. It is mainly a dramatic music with religious fervor of music of the ancient times, laying emphasis only on those musical excellences which enhance the bhava. There is, however, another interpretation to this term reflected in the singing pattern, where the music ascends gradually in speed from its slowest to the fastest, culminating into a crescendo, which signifies the attainment of moksha prapti, the attainment of salvation through music. Now here, the Kottipadi Sevakar, there is a procedure. Of course, it differs from the northern part of Kerala, the central part of Kerala, and the southern part of Kerala. The rendering of Sopana Sangeetam and the rituals are very, very quite different. I mean, they may differ to some extent. But what is important is that these pattern of rendering of Sopana Sangeetam are strictly, they have to abide by the time of the rituals. That is something that is followed everywhere in all the temples alike. And they sing certain shlokas or compositions which are called as dhyanis. Dhyanis are the dhyana shlokas. Now this dhyani is connected to every ritual. Suppose there is a dawn, the day is divided into five yamas, and each of this yama before the sunrise, at the time of sunrise, just before the noon, afternoon, evening, these are all being given certain names. And each of these, at that particular point of time, when the sun is just at the dawn, the sun is almost setting, till the time the sun is setting, different kinds of dhyanis are sung to ragas, which are very carefully selected and strictly adhered to. So there is a time theory of ragas maintained even today in the Sopana Sangeeta rendered in the Kerala temples. So the dhyanis or the dhyana shlokas, sometimes it's not very important that what sort of a shloka you are singing. You can sing in praise of Devi, you can sing in praise of any deity. But the raga for which that particular dhyani is to be rendered, that has to be very strictly adhered to as per the time in which the particular ritual is taking place. So there, this particular time theory of ragas comes into being in the temple, in the Sopana Sangeetam in temples of Kerala.
Thank you.
this was a typical paadi raga, which is not, which in Carnatic music is different, which is found exclusively in Sobhana Sangeetam, a very popular raga in Sobhana Sangeetam. Now it has been, once it came to the stage performances, once it was adopted by performances, arts like performing traditions like Kathakali, Krishnanatam, the expansion of that raga took place. So from a very little limited phrases, the raga has now expanded to a full-fledged raga. But here also you will find that all the notes in the Arona Vrona, there's no precise, if you ask me what is the Arona Vrona of Paadi, it's very difficult for me or anybody for that matter to actually say with authentication or with conviction, because there are few phrases which are very typical of this raga. And so long as the singer is adhering to that phrase, the entire raga structure is not required. Unlike you find in Carnatic music, for instance, a Shankarabharanam raga. If you sing that, if you are exploring in raga, Carnatic music, the entire, there is a grammar, there is a technique, the procedure that you have to follow, and you have to cover up the entire three octaves, which is required for a raga like Shankarabharanam. But when it comes to Sovana Sangeetam, the bhava becomes so important that they may omit many of the swaras and they need not follow strictly the Aruna Vrona. So here, the emphasis is on certain notes and certain phrases which maximum bring about the bhava. So here in Paadi Raga, you will find that what he has used is, even though this song Padam that you heard is supposed to be, if you want to place it, if the Raga Puritans want to place it in a particular scale, you can say Harikambhoji in today's 28th Mela of Carnatic music. But you will not find that it is in, it has much semblance to the Carnatic music Harikambhoji, because Rimma pa padani da pa ni ni pa ma pa sa da da sa ri ka ri sa ni 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 sa ni da pa. Now here we tend to get a color of what we call as shruti, but this particular raga has that. Padani da pa ni ni pa ma pa sa pa ma ma da pa ma ri sa. So there are so many colors of different ragas that come. What is important is da sa ri ka ri sa na 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 ra na. These are the phrases that are very typical of this raga, and this is what you must, you have, if you have heard it, the sound, if you heard this particular padam clearly, you would have perhaps noticed that these phrases keep on coming again and again and again. So these are certain differences between the sopana ragas, rendering of sopana ragas, and the rendering of ragas in Carnatic music. I'm not going much detail because as and when I get an opportunity along with my mother to give a demonstration of certain ragas, I'll certainly would very much like to come and give a demonstration here. It was from the 14th century onwards that the music of Kerala experienced an added charm and appeal through the introduction of Geeta Govinda, the Yogatmaka, musical opera of the great poet Jayadeva. It was brought to Kerala by the Vaishnava religious singers of Bengal, who sang them with simple expressive dance movement which they performed in the streets. The language of Geeta Govinda was easily understood by the people of Kerala, who had basic knowledge of Sanskrit, which was the base for their own regional bhasha. The lyrical style of Geeta Govinda was marked by soft, easy flowing syllables that captivated all lovers of music and poetry. The simple literary structure and fluidity of its prosody made it pliant to any singing style. The ragas, talas, and songs and vadyas in the temple music developed with distinct expressions, which were well advanced, imaginative, and sublime. The unique feature found in the songs, whether rendered at the temple rituals, religious festivals, and traditional theatres, or the folk, or even the popular, is their being set to meters. Now, this is where the time cycle, the Thala cycle, which we generally adopt and we are very, very strictly adhere to and very particular about the starting and the ending point of a Thala in classical music, is not so much in the Sopana tradition, where it is all set to a Chandobaddha Prayoga meter, in which there is only two ways, modes of rendering, that is a shashabda and nishabda kriya, that is a beat and a wave or a silence. Needless to state that these talas were in vogue much prior to the present day Sula, the Sapta talas, where the beat and the finger counts determine the varieties in a tala. I'd like you to listen to a small little excerpt of the Gita Govinda Ashtapadi, which was recorded by my mother for this multimedia project. Can I have the next slide, please? Please listen to the intonations that she has.
Gendum Achekta Chiram Anurakta Leta Grige Drishtva Tacharitam Mande Sagi Praga Manasi Jamande Sagi
of Nangyar Kuthu. This was existing in the temples of Kerala. And you find that you cannot really strictly call it a sopana, rendition of a sopana sangeetam, because here there is an intonation you find probably, and possibly those intonations have been adopted into the sopana singing pattern. But here they call it as swarikal, because there is only a single one or two notes, and lot of gamakas, lot of nuances and tonal modulations are there, which bring about the effect that particular character is trying to portray. So this is a small little verse that from the Gita Govinda, which Nangyar Kutta, one of the famous leading exponents of Nangyar Kutta, Srimati Usha Nangyar, is trying to recite here.
Atrandare cha kulata jana vartmagha samjata pataka iva sphuta lan jana shri vrindavana Madipayadam shujalai Diksundari vadana chandana bin
I just have taken another excerpt from the Gita Govinda, also from the same archival recordings, which differentiates. Now you find that when you sing the same raga in a Carnatic music, the emphasis is more on the melody, and certain gamakas which are exclusively found in Carnatic music, and trying to avoid those nuances, those intonations which are very, very typical in the sopana sangeetam.
Mm-hmm.
this, of course, was in composed in Carnatic music, Mohanaraga, which was composed by my guru, Srimati Akhila Krishnan, late Srimati Akhila Krishnan. For this particular project, she had composed it for me. I would very briefly go upon what all we have heard today and what I've spoken. Very briefly, I'd like to pinpoint certain differences that are very typical of Carnatic music and Sopana Sangeetam. Sopana Sangeetam is a Natya kind of music where the music is supposed to express the dramatic expressions of the actor, whereas dramatic expressions of the actor or the singer. Whereas the Carnatic music is a chamber music, which is based on certain musical excellences. Sopana music is based on the Taurathrika aspect, that is Gita, Vadya, Nritya, which was once, till the 13th century, which was considered to be Sangeetam. The term Sangeetam encompassed Gita, Vadya, Nritya. Whereas Carnatic music, by the time the Carnatic music, classical music came into being, the Nritya got detached and became an independent, exclusive independent art. Sopana music is best suited for male voices, whereas there is no such gender distinction in Carnatic music. In Sopana music, even the achala swaras, sa and pa, also are shaken, because there, even if they are to bring about help in the exposition or the expression of a bhava, even the sa, shajja and panchama also are shaken. Whereas in Carnatic music, they are supposed to be the base. They are the resting points, they are the resting notes, and so they are not the, they are achala swaras, not shaken. And there are certain typical nuances which are adopted in Sopana, which are not so emphasized in Carnatic music. Now, in Sopana music, it adopts the old Panpalaic scheme of Dravidian music, resembling the principles of Raga Anga Paddhati, which is supposed to be an extension of the Gandharva or Jati Sangeeta, in which certain swaras of a raga and phrases woven around them become prominent and frequent, while the rest are less emphasized, if not completely deleted. So here you find that there is some semblance of the Hindustani music with Sopana. Two, three factors that you find similar is, once, that there is a gradual ascent of the speed from the slowest to the fastest. Even though there is a vilamba, madhya and druta in Carnatic and Hindustani, the Carnatic has a madhya which is double of vilamba and druta which is double of madhya. Whereas Hindustani, you'll find that there is, the speed is so very gradual that you can only feel that there is the tempo rising, but you cannot really make a distinction between the vilamba, madhya and druta. Whereas in the case, this is the same procedure is followed in Sopana Sangeeta, where the music is the speed, the tempo gradually ascends from the slowest to the fastest, which is supposed to lead to a kind of a crescendo, and then comes back to the original tempo, which again you find in Hindustani kind of rendering of music. Now, in Sopana music, the raga alapana is very strictly, you must have seen in the Kathakali rendition, that the person who is singing, even the alapana, of course, this clipping did not show the alapana, but the rendering of the alapana is also set to a particular beat on the gong. And this is something you find in Sangeet Ratnakara, a treatise on music, which says that the rendering of a beat along with an alapana enhances the beauty of the singing. So Sopana Sangeeta adopts this kind of a singing of alapana with a soft beating on the gong. Now, this is not, of course, there in Carnatic music. And Padavinyasa also, when you, the splitting of a particular sentence or a word, that word is more emphasized, the phrase or the sentence, a particular word is emphasized again and again and again. In the case of Sopana Sangeeta, especially in Kathakali Sangeeta, when it is rendered, so as to bring out the complete maximum dramatic effect of that particular word. In the Carnatic music, you find sometimes a single word is split in such a way because it has to come to a particular time cycle. It has to finish. So the second half of that particular word goes into the next cycle. So there is a split of a word because there the tala and the raga, it becomes very, very important part of the rendition. And of course, there are many more. I'll be just briefly touching about that. Sopana, you'll find in the last slide, you will find that towards when you are going into a crescendo from the slowest to the fastest, the automatically the singer starts singing Hari Om Hari, because that is a kind of a way towards the moksha prapti. Whereas this kind of a singing is not found in Carnatic music, especially today. But I remember many years back, Mysore Somasundaram used to sing certain Nerival, improvisation of a particular line. He would sometimes suddenly go into another plane and he would start praying, saying words like Hari, Om and all that. That was there. So that means even Carnatic music probably, because it came from a devotional, it had a journey from the devotional point. So where these certain similarities were existing even in the Carnatic music before it took off and became a full-fledged stage concert kind of a system. And I would now end with a small excerpt again from the archives of the archival recordings. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for such a beautiful lecture showing the integratedness of music, dance and theatre, everything, all sort of, so many aspects within Sopan Sangeet. Had the opportunity to learn from Ustad Fahimuddin Dagar Saab, who also used to talk about how the movement of laya from the vilambit to the drut has to be so organic that it should not be perceptible.
Correct.
That this kind of a kind of an abrupt juncture that you shift within khayal and other modes of singing in Hindustani, you can make a very perceptible point from where the speed gets into the madhyalaya and then it gets into the drut. It's not so much there within the Drupad system as well. So that was one similarity. And also, when you say that Shadj and Pancham are also not achal within the Sopan Sangeet paradigm, this is also something again very similar to Drupad, because he used to demonstrate to me how the Shadj and the Pancham moves from one raga to the other, that the Shadj and Pancham are not the same in Bhairav, not the same in Todi. They have these Shruti sort of differences. But what I wanted to actually ask you is that it almost seems to me that what kind of relationship the Pushti Margi Bhakti Seva seems to have with the temples of North India and its relationship with Drupad, that it translates into a much more systematized form of presentation within Drupad, whether it be Darbari Drupad or, you know, what is performed on stage today. It seems to me that that is the sort of relationship that Sopan Sangeet has with Carnatic music. There is a sort of, say, versions of ragas which are performed in Sopan Sangeet which have similarity, like you showed, but not a one-to-one kind of a relationship with Carnatic music. So if you could also sort of illuminate what your thoughts are on this sort of relationship that Sopan Sangeet has with Carnatic music vis-a-vis what Pushti Margi Seva has with Drupad also. It seems to be very similar in that sense. Thank you.
See, Drupad, of course, has developed from what was what you called as the devotional aspect of music, which was found all over India. So when you say devotion, you will find that there is a lot of similarity no matter which part of the country you go to. Because the ultimate aim of a devotional music is that you have to reach a kind of a juncture where you are connected to the God. So how do you reach that juncture? The way to, because music is Shrestha Marga, so through music, you gradually, first you have to build in that kind of a feeling into you. The moment you enter a temple, you may get an environment, but to build up that feeling into you, you need some kind of music that creates that vibration within yourself. And automatically, when that vibration keeps on increasing along with the rising tempo of whatever music is around you, suddenly you feel that you get into a plane which is supposed to be what connects you to the next Almighty. Now the Drupad also follows the same tradition. Now it was only after the khayal came into being that, you know, a lot of freedom was given to the manner in which you could handle a raga. A lot of freedom was given. Drupad, they were very, very particular that this is how it has to be rendered, this is how it should be, their exposition should take place. Sovana Sangeetam also was very particular about that. Now, where the raga shuddhiti comes, that is there in Carnatic music. As I said, if you take a Mohana raga, which you heard just now, in Mohana raga, if you go by the Carnatic music system of tradition, you will find that there are very strict rules, lakshanas given for the rendering of a Mohana raga. But when it comes to Sopana Sangeeta, that Mohana, the Dhaivata Shruti may be a little above and below, depending upon how that singer is feeling at that time. He will not be worried about that Dhaivata should exactly hit the pitch point. Similarly, Gandhara. See, in Kerala, because of a lot of folk music, they say there is a Kairali Gandhara and Kairali Nishada. Now, what do you mean by Kairali Gandhara Nishada? It only means that there are certain pitches, certain shrutis, which actually the raga, that particular raga does not allow. But yet you are touching that. And of course, in some Karnataka ragas also you find the same. That's why we say Begada, Madhyama, or, you know, Gaula, Rishabha, we have that. Because even though it is a particular note of that Lakshana, you are slightly above and below. In Sobhana music also, so as to reach that particular bhava, you sometimes tend to have a phrase which may not actually belong to that particular raga. Mm. You add into that just because it gives rise to that feeling. So the feeling is most important in Sopana music, not so much as the raga shuddhati, which we say in today's Carnatic music. That is why, as I said in the beginning itself, that I remember distinctly in the 80s when I was learning Kathakali, and we had excellent singers. I mean, I'm not sorry, not in 80s, in 60s. I learned when I was hardly 5 years old, you know. And I used to listen to, when I became a teenager, that music was so soulful. But the Puritans of Carnatic music, who would be sitting in that front row, would suddenly get up and said, "This is not Shankaravarnam. Why are you touching? Why are you taking this phrase? And why do you go and touch this particular swara? It has not to be touched in this manner, not to be approached in this manner." And that used to disturb the whole singing pattern. And that lasted for a number of years, till now, very recently, when we started going deep, dwell deep into the musicality of these regional music. That's when we realize the beauty of what that lies within these traditions. And this is not just with Sopana music, this is with every tradition in our country. You know, we have so many beautiful musical traditions where you can't really say this is Todi Raga or this is Bhairavi Raga or this is particular Raga. But it has the essence of those Ragas.
Thank you so much for that, ma'am. And I feel particularly happy that you've used a lot of clippings from the National
Yes.
Cultural Audiovisual Archives. We'd like to encourage more people to utilize this rich content. Sir?
No words after this presentation. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you, Jasab.